Would you like to be for the baby girl?
Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ.
Amen. He's blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Amen. It's not just to thank the Lord for my job and for my this and that, but the blessings we have to come. Amen. It's wonderful to have life, health, and strength, and rent paid, and hello, I know, I think Ms. Becky and I both are sharing. Georgia Natural Gas visited us last week, amen, it was gas bill time. Hey, we got the bill, we got something to put there. Thank you, Lord, for those type of blessings. But look, we have spiritual blessings in heavenly places, things that the world wouldn't even matter about. We talked about the finished people and how we're praying for them this morning, and because of their opulence and their success and their financial wealth, that's all right to have that kind of stuff. But they're a spiritual blessing you and I have in Christ Jesus alone, something that the world can't do for us. So, in Christ alone.
Every prayer is in heaven.
Amen. Amen. God keeps record of it, doesn't he?
Alone, my hope is found.
preach word on this morning. We're going to get ready. We're going to look at the book of Genesis, chapter 11. That's not me. Put your mind there. That's not there. Genesis, chapter 11. We're going to be looking at verses 1 through 6. Genesis chapter 11. Right at the beginning of your Bible. This also is one of the passages we would have read on this last week. And looking at it, something just kind of jumped out at me. And the Lord gave me the okay on last evening or sometime over the weekend and said, okay, Robert, that's where we're coming from Sunday. I said, thank you, Lord. So we delved into the scripture. Of course, we listen to God, and God gives us a word to share on this morning, but it will come from this particular passage. Not a whole lot of reading, but Genesis chapter 11, verses 1 through 6 reads, it says, entitled Tower of Babel, and the whole earth was of one language, or one lip, and of one speech. And it came to pass, as they journeyed from the east, that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. And they said one to another, go or come, let us make brick and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone, and slime had they for mortar. And they said, go to, let us build us a city and a tower, whose top may reach unto heaven. And let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men builded. And the Lord said, behold, the people is one, and they have all one language, and this they begin to do. And now nothing will be restrained from them, which they have imagined or purposed or proposed to do. Why? Because they all have one language. There's all commonality. They're all here in this one particular area. So they decide, we're going to build us a city. We're going to build us some place to keep us safe. You're going to make us a tower to reach up into the heavens. Okay? This morning, for just a few minutes, I'm going to speak from the topic, what are you building? What are you building? Okay? This is an artist's depiction, of course, of the Tower of Babel. And this particular relief, the gentleman who painted this, I forget his name, but it's something the elder. In the foreground, in one of these pictures he has, he painted three of these. One of them was lost, and there are two of them that still remain today. And in the foreground, if we were to zoom in, you can see a picture of somebody that's supposed to be Nimrod, right? Because you realize he came here to this particular area. And when you look at the scripture, what we're taught here in Genesis chapter 11, it says that the whole earth, everybody on the planet now, only had one language. Think about it. Before the flood, right, in the beginning we had Adam and Eve. We had Cain and Abel. Cain slays his brother Abel. Adam and Eve have another son whose name we're given in scripture by the name of Seth. But scripture also tells us that Adam and Eve had other children. The earth became populated by these people. Sin was running rampant. We see in the book of Genesis that the Bible says that people were doing whatever was right in their own eyes. God comes down and said, I must destroy man. Man is wicked. And God realized the imagination, the things we were just wanting to do were even evil. So God comes to Noah, doesn't he? And now God tells Noah to build an ark because it's going to rain. It had never rained on the earth before. Noah and his sons and daughter-in-laws now are the only ones that were spared to realize in the flood. So whatever language Noah was speaking would have been the tongue that would have come out of the ark. You see where we're going with this now? So in Genesis chapter 11, it says there was only one language throughout the entire world. How can that be? Why? You have Noah and his sons, Ham, Shem, and Japheth, right? They would have spoken what their father taught, right? Aren't there some things sometime in your family, I know as parents, some verbs sometime we split, and some little sayings we sometimes say we wish our kids wouldn't pick up on, amen? And they go to school and say ain't, the teacher says, Robert, there's no ain't. It's isn't, it's not. But at home, you know, Robert heard ain't, and we we ain't gonna do it, what you ain't gonna, right? I heard ain't growing up. But you hear those sorts of things, and whatever language is spoken there is what you have. So the Bible here teaches that there was one language. So if all the people were singing off the same sheet, as it were, they could get a lot of things done, could they? Didn't need a translator, didn't have to have ambassadors to foreign nations. They were really all of one family anyway, right? Coming from Noah and his sons, and then spreading abroad from there. They were all related anyway. So they had one particular land, Scripture says. And it says they not only had one language, but they used the same words. That what they said, that what you call a dog was a dog, and what you said over here meant the same thing. Aren't there some things also in our language today? And in the idioms that we speak, especially here in America, some of the little sayings and cliches and whatever that we say that other people come and get, but what does it mean? What does it mean when you people say, that's cool? No, we say, oh man, that's cool. We may think that that's all right, that's good. You go to Finland and say it's cool, they probably don't even think about what? Bird, cool, amen, the weather. But see it here, not only says they only have one language, but they use the same words. Look at how they could really come together and agree to do things and make things happen. Wouldn't it have been wonderful if they had used that one particular language in one tongue to praise God all together? But we're going to see that that's not the story. We're going to see that even after God destroys the world with water and leaves just a remnant and starts over again, we're going to see how quickly men began to fall back into their old ways. So even though the actions and the people were washed away, guess what didn't change? There you go. That's what always amazes me when people talk about, well, I'm moving out of this area, I'm going to move to another area because it's this, it's that, and the other. The problem is you moving there. Whatever you left that area with, you know, we talk about people fleeing from this area, I'm going to leave this state, I'm going to do this. When you leave, guess what? You take sin with you. Why? Because it's in your heart. Wherever we go, we take that with us. But one language, and they use the same words. And it came about as they journeyed east, they found a plain, a wide open area in the land of Shinar, and this is where they settled. And here it is, they say one to another, come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly. And they used brick for stone, and they used tar, or it says slime, for mortar. Think about it. These people out in the open desert, in a plain, right? That's where it tells us they settle. No resources out there in a plain, right? We have plains here in America. When you go out to the plains and the dusty and the arid areas, there's not a whole lot out there, are there? I know in Texas, when you get around El Paso, you got tumbleweeds. You got cactus, roadrunners, whatever, all this kind of sparse stuff. There's no vegetation, right? There are no trees out there, per se, all in the open area. It's plain. That's why it's called plain. It's wide open. But they begin to settle here, but it's, you see here that all these people come together in this plain area. Look what they do. They say one to another, let us make bricks. They decide they're going to build them something. And notice here with the, I don't know, the lack of patience, if you will, because we hadn't had Galatians yet. We talk about fruit of the Spirit. But look, notice here what they get. And it says in the lack of patience in verse 3, why? Come, let us make bricks. But what does the second part of that say? Let's make them, and then what are we going to do? Right. They're going to make them, but then they're going to burn them too before that. Why do they burn those bricks? Normally, what would happen is you're going to make this brick, you put it out in the sunshine to dry. But guess what? That takes a little time, doesn't it? Hello, modern day society. We have an invention, I don't know when they invented it, I didn't look it up, but call the microwave. Back when I was growing up, child of the 60s, we didn't have a microwave. About the only thing we had different from our stove and our oven was something called a toaster oven. It didn't necessarily cook things faster, you just didn't have to turn the oven on if you want to make toast. But I can remember as a kid at my grandmother's house, y'all met my Mama Rita when she came for Thanksgiving. I can remember Mama Rita's house. But we would eat breakfast at her house, and I used to love the way she did it. The way she fixed toast, she'd take bread and put four pats of butter on that bread. A lot of butter. And she put it down at the bottom of that stove and turned that thing on broil. It wasn't no such thing even as a toaster. That's how we ate our toast. And I grew up eating toast like that, and I loved it. Why? Because it was crunchy on this side, but it was still soft. And yeah, Miss Becky, soft and bready on the other side, and that butter just sat there. Boy, you get to eating the bag. I like butter. My wife will tell you. I probably use a little too much, but I want to slather that butter on it. I like that flavor, right? But come along, somebody said the toaster oven and the oven wasn't good enough. So now we have what we call a microwave. Back when I was growing up, we had what they call Jiffy Pop. I can remember when we had popcorn, Mama would put it in a big old kettle, and Mama would begin to shake. And when the top started popping, we knew it was time for what? Popcorn. Now you have a little old bag, put it in a little old box, and in 2.5 minutes or sometimes less, you also can have what? Popcorn. Why? People are impatient. People sometimes quote us as being a microwave society. What does that mean, Brother Robert? We can't wait for anything. We have no patience. We want everything yesterday. But we can see that attitude isn't new. These people here couldn't even wait in what they were building. It said that they burned them thoroughly. They were heating up the bricks so they could build really quickly and really fast. Didn't even have time to take to let the bricks sit there and do whatever. That's the way it was normally done, right? But in order, like modern day, you think about a kiln when you send the bricks through. Go to some of those big companies, Acme Brick or whatever, and you go on some of the internet and see some of their video. They get all that stuff, put it together, send it through a kiln to get them out. They don't wait either. Why? Because they want to build something quick. They want to make that dollar really fast. These people weren't selling anything. They were just in a hurry for themselves. Think about what had just happened. They had recently come through the what? Flu. Right? God had destroyed the earth. Were they maybe fearful that something was going to happen again? Because if you notice in Scripture, the first time you see a city built, go back and look at it. The first time you see cities being built was by Cain and his people. Why? Cain was on the run, wasn't he? People build cities, and they built cities and fortified them back then for protection. God didn't put Adam and Eve in a city. He put them in the Garden of Eden. Back then, they lived in tents. They didn't need a big, strong church. Who are you going to be afraid of? We're all related. Even here, city people, y'all are all related. You came from Noah, and then his son, you all are all related. Who are you scared of? Who else going to fight you? Everybody else been wiped off? Who are you scared going to come get you? But they built up cities. Not only did they build cities, and they did it in a hurry by heating up these bricks, it says here, they burned the bricks and they used them for stone and said, and then they said, come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower. Why? Whose top will reach into heaven. And let us make for ourselves a name. Let's make a name for ourselves. God had already given you a name. You're who he said you were. You're Hamites, you're Japhethites, whatever. You come from Noah. You're all descendants of him. But now you want to make a name for yourself on earth. Why? And let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad over the face of the whole earth. Wait a minute. So you're scared about being scattered abroad? You're scared about going out? Why would you be scared to go out and do anything like that? God has already told you all the animals are not put into your suggestion. There's going to be a fear of you in the animals now. Why? Because you can eat them. It wouldn't be fair to the animals for you to go out there and say, man, I sure want some bacon, and a pig just run up and lay down that you're killing. Right? There's an instinct in animals. They run from us now. That was given after the fall. But notice what we read already when we read our scripture reading. In Genesis, chapter 9, when God told Noah, be fruitful, multiply, and fill the earth, that meant to do what? To scatter out. Not to stay all hemmed up together. He reiterated the same thing in verse 7 of chapter 9. And as for you, be fruitful, multiply, populate the earth abundantly and multiply in it. Anybody here ever remember, maybe, I don't know, I know we used to go out of town, we go spend the night with my grandmother. My mother had us, my mother's the oldest of 7 kids. She had me and my 2 brothers, that's 3 of us. My Aunt Carlene, her sister had 3 kids. Whenever we'd all get together at my grandmother, my mama's mother's house, there wouldn't be enough room for all of us. Because grandmama's house wasn't made for all these people. She had her kids and sent them out. But sometimes we come home, and I remember pallets in the floor. I remember sleeping head to foot down there, whatever, to make room. But that got to be uncomfortable, right? That was something we did every now and then. It would have been right for us to all stay there at grandma's house and let's be what? Built a bigger house, made some more room. When God told them to be fruitful and multiply and populate the earth, that meant to do what? Spread out. You can't, if you think about it, if you keep having babies, and you keep having babies, you can't keep them all in the same place. Eventually, you're going to do what? Run out of room. You're going to run out of resources. There has to be sanitation. God even gives them rules eventually on how there had to be rules. You couldn't all stay in the same place. It was meant for you. God said, populate the earth. You can't populate if you stay in one particular place. So by us saying we're going to build us a city, because isn't that what they said? Read the scripture. Let us build a city. By us building a city and a tower, that meant that us was going to do what? Stay right here. So we were defying God already, weren't we? We read that. Look at chapter 9. What did God tell them to do again? Chapter 9, verse 1, be fruitful and multiply. Chapter 9, verse 7, be fruitful, multiply, apply, populate the earth abundantly, and multiply in it. It said the earth. It didn't say right here. It said the earth, the entire area. Same thing he told Adam and Eve in the beginning too, didn't he? Be fruitful and multiply. So God begins to do it again. Be fruitful and multiply. But what do? We're going to be defiant. We're going to rebel. Nimrod's name meant a rebel. So here we go. We're going to build ourselves a city, chapter 11, verse 4, and a tower. Now, we're going to do this to reach up into heaven. What y'all going up into heaven for? Why are you trying to reach up that high energy? What was up there for you? Was it so you could look in and see what God was doing? Was it fear, thinking that maybe I could build this tower tall enough to where if a flood come again, we wouldn't be washed away? But didn't God already promise you that he wouldn't destroy you with water anymore? So what are we doing here? Am I questioning God? Lord, do I not trust you to save and protect me? Why? Because I got to build me a city? There again, who am I hiding from? The only people here on this earth are me and my kinfolk. Am I worried about some of my distant cousins coming to attack me? I mean, if I do, then we really got problems, amen? If I'm building up a city to keep them out. But they were building a city to fortify themselves to all stay in one particular area. When God told them, you don't need to be building anything. Go out there and be fruitful and multiply. Take the earth as what? Subdue it. He said, I've given all living things, what? To you for me. Just don't eat the blood with it. But God told them what they could do and told them what to do. But what did we decide to do? We decided to build something of our own. And guess what? Not only were they going to build something, then they had the nerve to say, and we're going to make a name for them. What does your name have to do with the grand scheme of things? I do believe if you read in Scripture, when we get to the end of the story, the Bible says that we get to glory, we're going to have a new name. So I won't be Robert D. Smith II anymore, even though I love my little name and my initials. I do. I like writing RDS at Roman. I like that. God has another name for me. So what good is doing me make me a name in this earth? What am I trying to do? Maybe trying to leave something for other folks to look at? Sad to say, Andre Crouch, I heard about that. He passed this week, 72 years of age. Soon and very soon, right? My tribute to God, be glory, all these wonderful things. He left a name, per se, behind him for that reason. And folks will remember him because of that. But I don't think he went into what he was doing just for that reason. But there are some folks who do. Some folks leave this and do that behind just so their name can be carried on, right? Trying to make a name for themselves. What does it matter in the grand scheme of things? As I've heard one preacher say, in 200 years, will it even matter? I can tell you what, it's been over 2,000 years since Jesus lived and died, and that matters. But the little things that you and I do, that we think we're going to do something that's going to last, how many things, oh my goodness, you can just go back and look at it. I read the story of Milton Hershey in Hershey, Pennsylvania. I read his book. It's a very interesting book. And some of the wonderful things he did and how he set it up, they don't do all that stuff like he did anymore. It would be nice if they kept some of those principles in place. That company's out to make money now. They try to do this, try to do that. Walt Disney, we got the Disney company now. Some of the things Disney does and what they're allowing people to do now, I guarantee you, I don't think Walt would have been down with that. But now his name carries on with that. We have to be careful sometimes. Some of the stuff we leave, somebody may take your name and do something totally different with it. Okay? I used to love to work at McDonald's when I was a teenager, but I was going to grow up and own my own stories. I wrote me a senior thesis about McDonald's. And learned about Ray Kroc and the McDonald's brothers out of California who he bought the name from and did this, that, and the other. Some of the things McDonald's does today and the way they do it, Ray Kroc wouldn't be pleased. I can tell you that from reading this book, writing it out. Mr. Kroc wouldn't be pleased with the way they're running the business today and some of the decisions they're making today. But they're all doing it, why? For that bottom line. So we have to be careful. But these people think that we're going to do something to keep us from God. We're going to build us a tower and make a name for ourselves. As if God really is concerned about your name. God knows how many hairs there are about the number of hairs on your head. Your name doesn't matter anything to him at all. But they wanted to make a name among themselves in the earth. Why? To lord it over other people. Notice here. He says. Let us build a city and a tower whose top will reach into heaven. Let us make for ourselves a name, lest we be scattered abroad. But isn't that what God told you to do, is to scatter, to go and be fruitful and replenish? So we scared to go do that. So we're going to make us a city with a big old tower in it and block ourselves off from the rest of the world. So, make ourselves a name, lest we be scattered over the face of the whole earth. But didn't God say, go and replenish the earth? Didn't he say, go and populate the earth? That was just two chapters before. I'm not sure time-wise how far ahead that was with what we're reading today. Said before that. It should have been long enough to where they didn't forget about it. Some of these same people we talked to were still around here when this came out. So all of a sudden now you're just going to just disregard what God said? I would guarantee you today there are some folks who call themselves a church, who call themselves Christians, or a member of some religious body who are building something that has nothing to do with what God told us to do.
Amen.
So that's where we're going with this thing today. We have lots of folks setting up stuff, putting together stuff, building stuff. God had bit more told them to do that. But to make a name for who? Hello. So that our church name can get out in the, who cares? I think scripture says, correct me if I'm wrong, didn't Jesus say, and lifted up? If nobody ever knows the name, Riverdale Community Baptist Church, if they know that we serve Jesus, that's what's important. It's not going to say, oh yeah, brother, your church is doing, ain't about what my church is doing or isn't doing. It's the Jesus Christ that we lifted up. If you see our church doing anything out there, prayerfully you hear about Jesus before you hear what the name of the church is. People have asked me before. We have some little postcards we pass out of our church. And people say, brother, why ain't your picture on there? You don't need to be coming to see me. But man, people need to know what kind of church. Don't they know? People have asked me before, Miss Becky, why are there pictures of different colored people on your car? Why are they all black people like you? I said, well, you know, we encourage any and everybody to come. As a matter of fact, in our church, we have some folks whose skin complexion isn't the same as mine. We even have folks come in this church who don't speak the same language as I do by birth. But guess what? God has blessed me to speak Spanish where I can speak it to them too. When Christ came, he came for everybody. People have looked at our website and said, well, brother, you ain't got no picture for you. Don't come looking for me. Because see, what happens is you come here looking for me. Ooh, I want to see that dude outside. Don't come looking for me. All I need to be looking for that dude you saw on the website is this woman right here. But you'd be surprised at how many folks see something. They see a picture of it, ooh, he sure look, boy, she look, and they come in, come on now, for the wrong reason. We're not an attraction model church. The Bible even says about Jesus, his form had no covenant. Jesus wasn't no debonair, no Adonis to where people would look at him and be like, oh, check Jesus out, look at them guns. He could have been that. He could have been a Samson, he could have been a whatever. But he wasn't that. He was just Jesus. So he could blend in and fit in and minister to everybody. But people have asked, that's done on purpose. That ain't because I don't know no better. I used to do printing and advertising. I know what to do if you just want to get folks in. We ain't trying to get folks in like that. We want who God will send you.
That's right.
So it's not about putting a picture. But put your family out there. People will see you got kids. If they don't know if I have kids, come and see me. You can meet every one of them. They'll tell you their name and they come and see them. It ain't about putting nothing out there for you to see. We do church in here like other people are supposed to be doing. What do you believe? The Bible. What do you preach? The Bible. What if it's not in the Bible? I don't preach it, I don't teach it. Y'all know I've said that.
Right.
But I guarantee there's some folks out there building up some stuff, putting together some stuff that God and Big Mo told them, trying to make a name for themselves. Trying to reach themselves up what above the other. I'm going to make my church so I can look down and we can be the big church or whatever. Who cares if you're the biggest in the city? Are you doing a work for God? We can be a little church doing a big work for God. I believe in scripture. I don't ever see where God took a whole lot of people to do anything anyway. He used Moses to deliver all the folks out of Egypt. Gideon had too many men, dwindled him down to 300. It took one David to defeat the Philistine army, what, by knocking out their big man, Goliath? Come on now. Jesus had 12 disciples, and the scriptures say one of them was the devil, so really about 11 of them working with him 3.5 years to change the world and turn it upside down. There again, does the brother Robert have a problem with numbers? Mm-mm. I love the vision of labor. The Bible says, praise the Lord of hosts. That he will do what? Send labor to make this work not just there easier, but so we can divide the labor. Right? That's why Jesus had those disciples. He told them to go out. Don't go out by yourself. Go out to have some help with you. So it's not that one church can do it alone. One person is to do it alone. Make a name for me. There are to be others that come alongside us, but they don't even have to be a member here to do that. I can share with them and be salt and light with somebody out there in the street, and God touch their heart, change their life, and they have a ministry of doing whatever it is God tells them to, may never come inside this door. Am I going to get upset? Mm-mm. I know some people will do it. But brother, we witnessed to you and you got saved and we doing street ministry. You can come to church tomorrow. You better be there and tell the folks how I... Who cares? Is it to get some kind of award? Is it to get some recognition? Is it to make a name for yourself in front of the people? When God knows your... and knows why you're really doing it? Is it just so you can put on a report that we had XYZ baptized this year? That we had a, just because you're getting folks and dunking them in the water, you baptize them, are their lives really changed? Or they just going in dry devils, coming up wet devils. I heard my pastor say when I was a kid. That's what happened to some folk. They just come down, they guilted into doing it. Well, my cousin did it. So, but then the Lord even touch up. Well, no, but I saw him do it. And then he got to eat them crackers. I know some kids who said that. I want to do it so I could eat the crackers and the juice. That's why. They knew that unless they were baptized, they couldn't. So, I mean, they just saw, they realized, huh, this is what I have to do this. No change. Right? But God had told, so what God had told them to do, they chose to do the opposite. God says, go and populate and replenish. Now we're going to build. And we don't want to be scared. We're scared. So, they say here in verse 5. So, the Lord came down. Now, guess what? We're building us a tower up to heaven. We have rocket ships. They just did a launch of this private rocket firm this last week. First time ever, right? They talk about how much money is wasted. You realize when a rocket goes into space, there's this great big old thing full of gas that gets it out of the atmosphere, right? Where it can get away from the gravitational pull. Hello, students in school, right? To get away from the gravitational pull of Earth, right? And when that thing, when the ship gets up far enough, that big old fuselage does what? Just comes down and does whatever. It's not to be used again. Well, this private company says, we're going to use that thing again. They took one up in the air and got it to come back and land on the barn just this week. But with all the rockets we have, and the Explorer satellite, the little rover that's way out wherever it is, no matter how high we think we can go, we're not going to be able to get up there where God is. Scripture shows us, as tall as this tower was, they were trying to build it up to the heavens. God still had to do what? Come
down.
Hello, somebody. God still had to come down. So you think you all that? God said, I still got to come down. No, you think you're building something. Hello, little man. You think you got cell phones now and voice recognition, cars going to be driving themselves, all this other kind of stuff? God says, I still have to come down. You're not going to reach me. So even with what they did, notice what Scripture said. Now, did God know what they were doing? Yes, he did. He just wanted to come down and inspect it for himself. God knew what was happening. This wasn't a surprise. But it says here, notice, God changed his position. Look at this. And it said, and the Lord came down to see. So even though they were building up, as high as they thought they were, up in the heavens, okay, whatever. God still had to come down. You realize this, y'all know this. We can go up so high to where we can't even breathe.
Right?
Up there in Colorado where the Broncos play, they talk about Mile High State and the air gets kind of thin up there. Ladies, come on now. I've seen this back when I was a little kid. And I used to try to cook with my brothers very rarely. But I could do rice. Well, sometimes when I would take that rice out of the package, it would say that if you were at different elevations, you had to cook it different.
Right.
Y'all remember that, ladies? You see that sometime even today on the back of your food? It says if you're at this particular elevation, you boil it different or you do it. High altitude, right? Even the recipes change. Why? Because the air is there. There's something different about as high as you go. Guess what? There's a limit to as high as I can go. When I do go in and out of space, I got to take some oxygen with me. Why? God didn't intend me to be out in space. Because there's none out there. If God wanted me to breathe in space, he would have had a tree. He would have done something to where I could breathe in out of space. Guess what? He gave the fish gills so they can breathe in the water. You think God couldn't have done something to equip me to breathe in space if he wanted me out there? We got enough to do with this right here. We messed this place up. This place is cursed because of it. We've done enough to mess this up. We're going to go populate Mars. We'll mess it up. We're going to go out and find Uranus and Venus. Leave us there for a while. We'll mess them up. We'll go out there and great bit of resource. We'll do this on Jupiter. Great big old ball of gas. We'll find a way to go siphon that stuff, bring it back here and use it. And before we know it, instead of being the largest planet, Jupiter will be whatever else, because we'll find a way to mess it up. Amen. But no matter how high we go, even if I go way out there. As a little kid, there was a little song just saying, somewhere in outer space, God has prepared a place. The countdown's getting lower every day. Right? Somewhere in outer space, meaning as far as I can go. If I even get out there to Pluto, the furthest planet they say we have, now they see other stuff, I still can't reach God.
Right.
Wherever he is, he still got to come back to give me. Look at the awesome God we serve. And you mean, God, you're going to tell me, look, God, you spared me. Number one, you saved me from the flood. All you said is, Robert, go live your life. And Robert, guess what? You don't even have to be a vegetarian. Oh, boy, go get you some meat if you want to. Ooh, Lord, thank you. He said everything, right, didn't he? Right up to this point, everything that liveth is for you, for me. Just don't eat the blood. So God is not only, he's shown me some grace in not killing off everything and starting over. He's going to start with his one family. Here I am left behind. He said, Robert, eat what you want to eat, son. Go have some babies and just populate the earth. How hard is that? How hard is that? But what I decided to do, well, now I'm going to do this. I'm going to build this here. I'm not going to be scattered. We're going to all stay here together. Come on. Now, anybody ever had a relative over sometime and you love Aunt so-and-so, Uncle whoever? But after a while, Uncle, when you say you're leaving again, what time is your flight? I mean, you know, love you, Uncle. But now, if Uncle had to stay with you, that's different. When you know it's for a temporary amount of time, it's like, because you have your routine. And Uncle, he may like to get up early. He want to do this. We don't do that. He stay up late watching TV. Man, I got to go to work. Little things happen. I don't love Uncle so-and-so, but that's why you grow up and you get your own. That's why God told him to replenish and populate, spread out. But what do they say? We're going to build us a city, lest we be scattered. We're scared to go out there and be scattered, so we're going to stay right here. So we're going to defy you. So God, what you told us to do, we're not going to do that. We're going to do what we want to do. You mean after all this I've done for you, I've spread and you still here, eat, have babies, you can have what you want to, da, da, da. No, we're going to do just the opposite. We're going to do what we want to. So God comes down, verse 5. To see the city and the tower, which the sons of men had built. And the Lord said, so they had finished by now, and the Lord said, behold, they are one people. They have all the same language. And this is what they began to do. Look, God said, look at what they're doing now. And now nothing which they purpose to do would be impossible. And why? Because they're all on one accord. That's a beautiful picture and example for us in the church today. In the church today, we ought to all have one common language. And that'd be the scripture that's in the Bible. If we'd all have one common focus, one common purpose, there's a whole lot the church could do today, and we could all get together. But unfortunately, that doesn't happen. And even some of the better of your church, it's hard to find it. It's hard to find it. So God said, look, if I don't come and do something, man, you do. So then we get to the confusion of the languages. I believe right now I heard that there are over 3,000 or 3,500 different languages in the world just today. Now, I do speak Spanish. But guess what? I can talk to some Puerto Rican people, and some of the things that I learned in school as Spanish, in their country and their language is different. I can understand some Cubans, but some of the things they say is different. Portuguese ain't no way. Because it's totally different. People in Brazil, I can get a little bit of it, but I learned Spanish. Even in that particular language, right? They're a different dialect. So just because a person comes from Spain, he couldn't just go to Mexico and think he's gonna fall and fit in. The Mexicans, which came from Spain, they took when they got to Mexico and added some of their own little stuff to it. Hispanics here in America. When I'm sometimes teaching or preaching in Spanish, some of the idioms and things I use, they don't use that term. They say, oh, Mr. Robert, we say, because they're from Guatemala or El Salvador, they're of Latin descent, right? They're what we call Hispanic per se. But some of their idioms and things are different. So many different languages. God did this. We talked before about the differences in the color and what does that up. If God wanted us all to be the same, we would have left us that way. But look and see what happened when that happened. What were we doing? Instead of using that for good, we decided we're going to build us somewhere and go up to heaven and see what's going on up there with God. Can you imagine if they'd actually been able to get up there and read some kind of way? Remember what happened with Moses, right? When God came close, God told him, you can't look at me, Moses. You can just check my glory out as I could. You can't look at me. I'm too glorious. I'm too pure. You're sinful, son. You look at me, man, you'll be destroyed. Could you imagine if them foolish people had actually got up there and they started looking around and the first thing they caught a glimpse of, that would have been it. They would have wiped themselves out. There you go, that's it. Running toward the, that's right. Flying toward the light. Not knowing exactly. And God said, I'm going to go down here and see. Because they're one people, they have the same language, and this is what they began to do. So I asked us now, what are we building today? Are we doing, God told them, what they should have been building was families, populating this earth. That's what they should have been doing, but they decided to go do something like this. Totally opposite of what God said. Why? To make them a name. So that we wouldn't be scared. They were scared. They were trying to protect themselves. For whatever reason, God already told you, I'm going to destroy the water again. Why are you building a tower? People do that, right? Go back and look in the Bible. Look in the Old Testament. When we talk about Joshua and the Battle of Jericho. When they had these buildings and these cities and these fortifications with the towers to do what? To look out and see which way to what? The enemy's coming from. Who was going to come and attack you? Who was left? Nobody but you. God said the animals are scared. You have to worry about the lion coming out to eat you up. God put a fear of you in him. So now Leo gonna run from you. He may be king in the jungle, but you got it. So what were you been? Who were you hiding from? Sometimes in our own mind, right? Knowing how I am, knowing I ain't right. And boy, if I got a chance, I would take advantage of it. They probably got to think in the same way. Pretty soon, somebody, because remember now, Nimrod, his name, the senator that come and found his place of Nimrod, they were rebels. He was a rebel. And he was a conqueror. He was a hunter. He was a hunt man. And there was even a little proverb saying about him that he was a hunter almost like God. I'm pretty much saying that his hunting ability and his skill would be that to rival God. That was a little saying about him. You know, amongst the people. You know how people build folks up? Like we have John Henry, right? Like we have Paul Bunyan. All these little folks. Like in Texas, we had, Texas Bill? The one that would ride the rodeo, ride the cyclone? I forget. We had one in Texas, too. But anyway, but those little fables, those little tall tales we talk about, those little lies we make up. They had one, they were going around with Nimrod. Oh, how great he is. Oh, what he can do. He's a hunter on equal place with God. He can do whatever. And all this kind of stuff. Maybe they were thinking, if he's that way and if he can do this, maybe I can go and conquer and do whatever. Who knows what the reason is. What we do know is they were going against him. They were building something God hadn't called them to do. They were trying to do something God hadn't called them to do. All the time and resource they took in building, and believe me, this was done. Even though they were one people, it still took some time. They didn't have cranes and like we have today to do something and put it up real quick. It took some time to do this. What could they have been doing for God in the meantime? While some folks are out here doing this, who was staying behind teaching and maybe training up some of their kids? Why? We're busy doing this. We're doing something God didn't tell us to do. We should have been having more people, having more kids, and populating the earth. We can't do that. Why? Daddy's too tired from working and doing these things. Mama doing whatever. Instead of doing what God told them, they weren't given a whole lot to do. Be fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth, and every living thing now is meat for you. God didn't give them a whole long laundry list of stuff. Do this for me, God. See, they couldn't do it. God gives us simple things to do today. We want to come out and take on something that's not even for us. Try to put something together. Try to do something God had called us to do. Now, what should we have been building? Let's go back and look at Matthew 16, what we read already. In our New Testament reading, I'm about to close. In Matthew 16, when Jesus asked the disciples here, it says, now when Jesus came unto the disciples, Matthew 16, 13, from the district of Caesarea Philippi, he began asking his disciples, saying, who do people say that the Son of Man, is? And they said, some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, but still others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. He said to them, okay, y'all are right here with me. You say, who do you say that I am? And here's old Peter, Mr. Always Speak Up, Mr. First One to Think, First One to Speak, I don't know about thinking. Peter says, thou art the Christ, the Son, the meaning of the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Jesus answers and says, blessed are you, Simon Barjona, because flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I say also unto you that you are Peter, Petros, and upon this rock, not you, but upon this rock, the fact that I am indeed the Christ, I am indeed the Son of the living God, he says, I will build my church. So who's going to be doing the building anyway? Jesus. He said, I'm going to be it, right? We come along and we fill the church. We are the church, but he's the one that laid the foundation. Right? We do realize that later on, Peter's called a pillar, but the pillar would be resting on the what? Foundation. Upon this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not overpower. Then in verse 19, what does he say? And I will give you the keys. So why are you trying to build a tower and get up into heaven? We don't have to do that. We don't have to break in like these. What does he say? I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. You want to have the keys? You want to be able to really get there? You don't have to build a tower. You don't have to try to find some other way to sneak in. The keys are freely given to us, and whatever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Want to get to heaven? You don't have to build a tower to do it. You don't have to go contrary to God's word and try to find you another way. That's what's wrong with the world today. People want to tell you, you don't need to believe in Jesus. You don't believe to do this. You don't need to do that. I do believe Jesus said, I am the way, not a way, the truth, and the life. He is the only way. But guess what? When I get there, I have access to heaven. I get the keys to the kingdom. When you have somebody standing with you in a house sometimes, they're just a house guest, you don't generally give them keys. They get in when you're there. Right? But when somebody comes along, somebody has residence there, somebody has authority and permission to be there, they generally get a set of what? Keys. To go in and out freely as they need to, right? Come in, change clothes, come in, take a shower, come in, get something, you get a key. You and I, as citizens of heaven, get keys to the kingdom. I don't need to build no tower, waste my time doing it. And all the time I take doing this, there are other things around me that need to be done. Somebody going to hell that I can't witness to, well, because I'm building this, I'm on this thing, I'm doing this here. How many of our churches today are caught up in building things and doing things and part of things that they shouldn't even be part of instead of doing what God told them? The list of things he left for us even to do today, it's not a very long, extensive list. But we don't even do those basic things. We want to go ahead and take on a whole other what? Project. And build us up something to make what? A name for ourselves. To be able to say, well, from last year to this year, we gained XYZ members, and we got this much more money. Who cares? How many people, how many souls were won for Christ Jesus? How many lives were changed because God allowed you to be here another year? Did anybody see the salt and light in your life because God left you here? 2014 to 2015. Or was it all about you? It's all about what you can do for yourself. Amassing wealth for yourself. Amassing knowledge for yourself and your family. What about those that are out there that are lost? So the question to ask them and the answer only you can give is, what are you doing? What are you building? What are you putting your effort into? What are you putting your time and your heart into today? And is it contrary to what God told us to be doing? Instead of building his church, instead of like it says in Acts chapter 2, about the people having all things together and coming, and the Lord added to the church daily such as he sees fit. But how does he add daily? Somebody got to give him the word. Are we out there doing that, or are we too busy doing other little things aside from that? Not giving God space, opportunity, or time to do that, because I'm too busy about what? Trying to make a name for myself. And with that, what we have to do is do what? It involves surrender. Seriously. It involves surrender. Lord, I surrender myself. seen what the folks on TV got, and what they call this brother got a TV manager, because that church is doing this, and we want to be like, now, we want to be like Jesus. Lord, we want to be doing what you told us to do. And guess what? What you're telling us, because it's not always in Scripture, right? God has given us instructions in Scripture, but guess what? He speaks today. It's just not a laundry list of stuff in there to do to check out. God speaks, or he should be speaking to us daily, guiding our life. Don't you see all the time in Jesus' life how he prayed to the Father, how he communicated with his Father? Jesus knew what his ultimate goal was. He knew when it was going to happen, how it was going to happen, but still, he was in constant communication with his Father for guidance, for direction. Who are we to think that we can just make it because, well, if I get saved, if I do this, I'm going to be in heaven. But don't bit more have a relationship and do anything to build on that with God when we build on all this other foolish stuff. Okay? I surrender all. Matthew chapter 22, verse 37. Somebody read that.
Jesus said unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind.